Kid, seriously.
Welcome to the AAF update. It's me, Miah Madrid, here giving you the scores and analysis from everyone's favorite startup football league. It's the Alliance of American Football. Big shout out to my main man, Luke Neitzel, who's offered to edit this for us. Thank you, Luke.
Yep.
Apologies for a lack of an episode last week. No, I wasn't licking my wounds after an awful 0-4 showing on my picks from 2 weeks ago. Maybe I should have been. Unfortunately, my dog passed away, so I had to put that all on the back burner. But I'm back now and ready to go. Let's get to the games. The first game was the Apollos all over Birmingham, my Birmingham, in a battle of the top two teams of the East. Garrett Gilbert, still the best player in the league, completing 23 of 35 for 285 and two tutties. Now, you and I have talked a lot about Gilbert and Spurrier and the fun and gun and all that stuff, but their defense makes plays. And Birmingham, who used to seem like they were the model of consistency, benched Luis Perez for Keith Price, and while it helped a little bit, there was no stopping the juggernaut. Apollos 31, Maya's Iron 14. Game number two of the week was the one of the best games in league history. There were a ton of turnovers, a ton of throwing the ball down the field, and a ton of lead changes. Mike Berkovicki, who Martz benched in game one, and that was the guy who got lit up by the Commanders player that had everybody making gifts and all that stuff. It wasn't pretty, but he got the job done. On the opposite end, Josh Woodrum, the Stallions QB, did not play particularly well, but he led Salt Lake on a scoring drive with under a minute to play. But Berkovicki, however, threw a fade to Dontez Ford to put the Fleet into field goal position with under 10 seconds to play. Donnie Hageman knocked it home, and the Fleet win again. Game three, Aaron Murray, former Georgia quarterback, finally got to start for Atlanta. He threw for 300 yards while Tarian Foster had 83 on the ground and scored a touchdown. Look out, everyone. Atlanta has risen from the dead and now pushing for a playoff spot. Memphis falls to 1-4. Atlanta 23-20. Final game was a microcosm of what this league is turning into. From game to game and even from play to play, you really have no idea what to expect other than to expect the unexpected. San Antonio burst out to a 26-0 lead at halftime before the Hotshots came storming back after the break. Their best efforts, however, as Shannon Doherty would say, were too little and too late. Commanders 29, Arizona 25. So those are the recaps of the games. Man, it's time for the rankings. And there was a moment when I was watching the games that I realized that there is a good chance that me and absolutely no one has any idea what's going on in this league. Like, from 1 minute to the next, it's just crazy. The Hotshots look great, now they're awful. The Fleet in Atlanta look done. They look done for, and now have come storming back. Everyone in the league is switching quarterbacks, like, all of the time. It's a lot to keep up with, but don't worry, Luke. I got you covered. Here we go. Number eight, Memphis Express. Not only are they bad, but they have an easy pair of quarterbacks to root against, and they are not fun to watch. They're 1-4, and they're now the new worst. Number seven, I have to eat some crow here. I thought the Stallions were going to make a run for a brief shining moment. I looked brilliant. They looked great in that one win that they had. But it takes more than a good edge rusher to win, and Woodrum and backup Austin Allen aren't going to get it done. That being said, they should have, would have, could have beat the Fleet, so the pack is pretty tight here. Parity abound. Number six, more crow. My former number two team, the team that I thought was a surefire, no pun intended, candidate to represent the West on the last day of the season, the Arizona Hotshots. They have looked not so good. Number five, in 2 weeks, Atlanta went from being the doormat to now having an outside shot at the playoffs. They should have played Aaron Murray earlier. They should have fired their OC earlier and gotten Zampezi in the first place and never tried with this whole Michael Vick experiment. Number four, now it's getting tough. There's three teams all vying for the number two slot. I think the worst of that bunch is the San Diego Fleet. I don't know what it is about Mike Martz. I just hate him. I always have hated him. I think it's just his face. It's probably my own bias, but he's proven me wrong before. We'll see how that turns out. Number three, this pains me to say it, Luke, but it's the Birmingham Iron, and I was tempted to go four here for them. Their luck has run out the last 2 weeks, and having a great D is cool and all, but you have to have some offense some of the time, and I'm not sure if Price is going to get the job done at quarterback. My number two then, I've been kind of surprised the last couple weeks about San Antonio, the Commanders. Granted, they just squeaked it out versus the Hotshots, and I have them ranked, what do I have them ranked, six. But I don't think the difference between 2 and 6 is all that great. The Commanders have a solid play all around, and now it looks like their turn to be the flavor of the week in the West. That leaves number one, the only one, the pride of the league, The only pick I feel confident about, because the rest is crazy, it's the Apollos. I picked against them 2 weeks ago. I thought Seattle was going to beat them in the bad weather, and it actually snowed that game, the Apollos won. Then I thought for sure Birmingham was going to have to make their luck run out. There's no way that they're going to be able to play as well against the Iron as they've been torching all those defense, and the Apollos kicked their ass. The Apollos are the best team in the league, and they're getting better while other teams are still figuring themselves out. It's the Apollos all day. So let's talk about the week's picks. Are you ready?
I'm ready.
All right, Luke, hey, we're on the back half of the season now. Doctor Strange would say we're in the end game, and so I better get some wins quick here. This is going to get embarrassing. Memphis at Salt Lake in the Battle of the Bad. Call me a fool. I'm picking Salt Lake again. I know I've been burned so many times this year with these guys, but I'm picking Salt Lake. Arizona at Orlando. I will not make the same mistake, okay? Orlando is going to win this game. I'm picking Orlando until – I'm picking Orlando probably every game for the for here on out. San Antonio versus Atlanta. My heart says Atlanta. They've been playing so much better. Again, they have the coolest logo. They have the coolest team name. Like, I want them to be better, but it's I'm going to go with my head here and pick the Commanders because they look hot right now. Finally, Birmingham versus San Diego. I got to pick my hometown team, or not my hometown team, but my home love team, the guy, team that I like, but I'm not going to. I'm going with Mike Martz and his stupid face. Just because I've been wrong so much, I'm going to pick San Diego over Birmingham. It makes me sick to my stomach. So there we go, Luke. Those are my rankings. What questions do you have?
Is Orlando going to lose a game in 2019?
I don't think so. I don't know who can beat them. They're just getting better and better. With every game that Gilbert learns more of the fun and gun offense, it's just clear they have so much talent that even if teams could scheme Spurrier out of the building, wouldn't matter because the talent is better. They have a good defense. They have like a top three defense. They have the best playmakers. They have the best running backs. And they have a quarterback who's proven time and again that he's the best player in the league. So I don't see how they can. But you know what? I've been wrong before when it comes to this. So who knows?
Well, and then the follow-up to that is if they are an undefeated team and they continue to dominate in the fashion they have, how many of these players have a realistic shot of being on NFL rosters come September?
Well, right now, DeShone Kizer is the Packers' backup. If you told me today that we were going to sign Garrett Gilbert, I'd be like, sold. That's the backup. Like, and I think he's got to be gone. I think Charles Johnson's got to be gone. I think Ernest Johnson, the running back, their whole stable of running backs really has got to be gone. I think so many of those playmakers on defense, the cornerback whose name is slipping my mind right now, like he's got to be gone. Like these dudes can play. These dudes can play. And so I think that's one of the fun parts about the league is like, I hope these guys get shots. You know, I hope some of them get shots and then some of them will get cut and they come right back to their old team. And I really want that sort of back and forth that you see in other leagues in Europe. And one of the things I liked about European soccer was, you know, teams going from the second division to the first division and sharing players and loan deals and all that sort of thing. And that's obviously never going to happen in the same way. And I don't think that it should, but I think the idea of, you know, a guy, the coolest story about the XFL was Rod Smart. He hate me. Right, going and then like having a career. So every time you thought about Rod Smart, you thought about the XFL and that moment, which was the only good moment that league ever had. And so I want stories like that because I love this league and I want it to continue and I want those players to get a shot.
Well, and you'd have to think with the amount of bad quarterbacks there are in the NFL, someone's sitting there going, you know, the Steelers got a lot of good years out of Tommy Maddox. Like he's not a Hall of Famer, but he's better than a lot of guys that were drafted first overall. So why not take a chance on some of these guys? You're going to be able to sign them for cheap, I bet.
Well, I think you're absolutely right. And I was thinking, like, I don't know offhand, who's the Vikings backup? Or who was it last year?
It wasn't Joe Webb.
Well, that's something to be thankful for. But you know what I mean? Like, you look at all the backups, like, Chase Daniel's a good backup for the Bears, but, like, would you rather take a flyer on Garrett Gilbert as a backup? Like, you look at all these teams, like, there's so many bad backup quarterbacks, like, just awful. Like, why not give him a shot?
Well, and you think, too, you look at a guy like Case Keenum, and we've seen those stories so many times where a guy has eight great games, and then another team gives him all this money to bring him over there, and then he bombs out as a starter, and they shuffle him off. So if you're willing to bet on those guys, you know, why not bet on some of these guys?
Right. And especially, like you said, you can get them for cheap. You can get a backup quarterback prospect for cheap. Now, Garrett Gilbert, big, strong guy, big in the pocket. I wouldn't be surprised if Denver, you know, Denver just got Joe Flacco, but they're getting rid of Case Keenum. They're sending him to Washington. Maybe Denver is a potential landing spot for Gilbert, you know, depending on what Arizona does with Josh Rosen. Now that they're thinking about talk, or the talk is Kyler Murray is the guy. There are lots of good landing spots for backup quarterbacks. You can, hey, Green Bay again, man, if you told me today that DeShone Kizer was out and Garrett Gilbert was there, I'd be a happy camper.
Well, what are you going to think about a Blake Bortles-led Apollos next season?
If you believe in Spurrier, all things are possible. Speaking of all things being possible, Luke, I want to give you another shout-out for recording and editing this show. I'd like to thank the rest of the folks who hit us up. If you want to reach out and mock me for those terrible picks, especially the ones from 2 weeks ago, feel free to shout out on Twitter. You can reach me at Miah Madrid. Hope everyone gets a chance to take in some of the games. Until next week, everybody.